An introduction to linear transformations. Well, this is a topic that we will develop in more detail, spend more time on, but we're introducing it today. okay, but first, before I do, I want to mention a theorem about when you have matrix times a vector, which we talked about in the last video. So suppose A is an N by M matrix. This means we have N rows, we have M columns. Okay, very nice. Then I need two vectors. N R M and K is a scalar. Okay, so then there's two parts. Maybe I'll do them in black. Part one says that if you take A, X plus Y, that this equals AX plus AY. And part two says if you take A times KX, that this is K like this. Okay, now, this is properties about matrix times a vector, and they're quite important ones. I should say number one is proved in your book using the viewpoint of looking at the rows of A, and that A times a vector, you take the rows of A dotted with the vector, that gives you the entries, right? We discussed this last time. I think what I'll do is just prove number two. Okay, so we will prove number two, and the proof of one is in your text, but also I'm going to prove it using the other viewpoint, which is that A times X, or in this case A times KX, is a linear combination of the columns of A. So let's suppose that A, well, I need some columns. How many columns do I have? M. So it's going to be, let's say, V1, V2, V3 to Vm are the columns . Maybe I should make a little bigger of a bracket. So this is a matrix. Now it looks a little bit better. And V1, V2, etc., columns of A. And we need entries of X here. X1, X2, it's a vector in R, M. Okay, then what do we know about, well, I want to show that if I take a constant or a scalar, multiply it by the vector X, and we know how to do this. We just multiply each entry by K. And then I multiply by A, that it's the same thing as that scalar times AX. So let's do that here. Now this is correct. AKX equals, here's A. Okay, I'll say it again because there was a mistake on the board. My apologies. Here's A, here's KX, linear combination of the columns. You see here, there's a K in every single term. So I may factor out, where should I even write it? I'll come down below here. There's a K here, and then times X1 V1 plus X2 V2 plus X3 V3 to XM VM. And then you see, for example, this, if you look at what A is, look at what X is, this is exactly A times X. Okay, so we see, well, now I will finish. This is exactly K AX, okay? Okay, very nice. And this is a very important property that we're gonna see again later today. Now, what I wanna move towards is linear transformations. Okay, but Before I do, I'm going to remind us of some things that you have likely seen, which is the notion of a function. In fact, I know some of you have had math reasoning where functions are relations, right, with some properties. Well, I'm not going to go that abstract at the moment, although I certainly enjoy thinking of functions that way. But let's recall what a function is. But I'm really interested in the vector spaces Rm and Rn, okay? So a function f, and this will go from Rm to Rn. Okay, well, I'm gonna say it this way. It is a rule that, let's say, assigns to each vector in R here, M, a unique vector in Rn. What's an example Okay, I thought of one. This is one that you might have seen from Calc 2. Let's take f of x1, x2, x3 is the square root x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 squared. So you would have seen this in Calc 2 when you were taking the magnitude of, for instance, velocity, if you wanted to compute the distance traveled in space or something like this, and you have a velocity vector and you compute its magnitude or length. Remember this? Maybe. Okay, Calc 2. In any case, this is a function. So here, this is a function from R3 to R1. But this function is not what I'm going to define next, which is called a linear transformation, but without a doubt, this is a function. What else can I say before we move on? Some common terminology with functions, the domain of a function. Sometimes these are referred to as the inputs. Well, it's here, it's R, M, okay? And sometimes this is called codomain of a function. Let me see what your text calls it. I almost forgot. They call it target space. I want to make sure I use the terminology and notation of the text. This is the Rn. And then there's sort of one other thing that comes up, which is sometimes referred to as the image, sometimes referred to as the range. And this is what actually is hit by the function, if you want to think about that. This is the set of all, let's say, f of x vector such that x is in R. I haven't used this in Rm. This is what's actually hit. So for instance here, this was this function that you hopefully remember from Calc 2, where you just take the length of a vector or magnitude. You see, this does not fill out all of the real line. The image here, sometimes it's denoted MF, is just this. Right, because you can't fill out, you can't have negative numbers. Well, this is just background on functions, and you've likely seen this idea before. Of course, for a general function, you don't have to have Rm and Rn here, but really these are the ones we're going to look at. Now, let me talk about the it's here, linear transformations. These are functions, but it's not every single function from Rm to Rn. In particular, the one that I had written, where you take the length of a vector. This is not a linear transformation. So let's define that now. Definition, a function, now I'm going to call it t, from Rm to Rn, is a linear transformation. Okay, I'm not going to try to fit it there. I don't know if I have space or not. I'm just going to move it right here. It's a linear transformation provided, well, there exists a matrix. There is a, this would be a n by m matrix, a such that t of x equals this a times x for all x in this domain. Okay, so this says the linear transformations are the ones that are just a matrix times the x, or, well, that there exists, so you can find, and I will tell you very shortly how we find the matrix A if you are given a transformation. But I want to make a comment that is an important one about you're used to linear functions, and you notice I didn't say linear function, I said linear transformation. So let me back up and just, I'll put this in quotes here. Linear functions in the sense of calc, whether you've had calc 1, calc 2, calc 3, what are the linear functions? Well, for example, f of x is ax plus b, f of x y is ax plus by plus c, or you could keep going however many dimensions here, f of x, y, z, ax plus by plus c, z is, oh, equal, plus d, excuse me. These are functions that that the graph, this is a line. If you graph this in 3-space, it's a plane. If you graph this in 4-space, so you'd have w equals to this. This would be, well, it's called a hyperplane. It's a 3-space sitting in 4-space. This is what's referred to as linear function. These definitely go, so these map from, all of these map from, let's say, Rm to R1. But they're not all linear transformations, okay? These are not all linear transformations in the sense of linear algebra because, well, let me make an observation. Maybe I will erase the definition and I will make an observation about linear transformations, and then we'll come back to this. If we take N by M matrix A, okay, and we take A times 0. Now this is the 0 vector. When we write this, maybe it's 0 in R2, maybe it's 0 in R5, maybe it's 0 in R11. It's whatever the 0 would be in the vector space that you are working in, okay? Which is just the column of all zeros, right? So let me think about this. Well, this zero, just for a sanity check, if this is n by m, this zero is m by one, and then these match, and we would get something that is n by one, for example. Okay, well, this would be a times all of this. Now, if you think about this, maybe I'll think about rho dot the vector for the moment. You take a rho of A, whatever it is, doesn't matter to me here because I'm dotting with zero. You dot with zero, so you multiply and add, okay? Well, you can get a zero because you're taking zero times, zero times, zero times, zero times, adding it up. So every single entry over here is going to be zero because, well, my argument was that zero dot any vector is zero as a number, and this gives you that every single entry here is zero. This is n by one, which is zero. Okay, what does this say about linear transformations? Well, it says something very important. If T is a linear transformation, then we must have that T of zero equals zero, okay? It must be because, well, there is some matrix such that T of X is A times X for every single x. So in particular, T of zero is A times zero, that zero. So this holds for every single linear transformation. But if you notice here with these linear functions, this one evaluated at zero is B, this one's C, and this one's D. And so they're not all linear transformations just because. Maybe I will add to this that we need that here, and it's not always. Okay, so these are usually, if you're in the linear algebra world, they're referred to as affine, whereas in calculus you might have called them linear functions, but they're not linear transformations in the sense of linear algebra because of this, okay? Well, now here's a question. So I'm now giving you a matrix. What is the linear transformation that corresponds to this? This is this 3x3 identity matrix. Has ones down the diagonal, zeros everywhere else. Well, okay, we know the transformation would satisfy that T of XYZ is this matrix times XYZ. Now, what happens when we multiply? Whichever way you think about it, linear combination of columns or row dot the vector, what do you see we get? Well, maybe I'll quickly row dot the vector. Here we get X. Okay, then here, Y, and then here, Z. Well, what transformation is this? This is the identity map. So T goes from R3 to R3. This is the identity map. Namely that, well, you see it here, T of any vector just comes back itself. And that's the one that corresponds to this matrix.
What I'd like to do is look at the effects. So we just discussed every linear transformation by definition. There is some matrix such that T of X is A times X. So let's look at some that go from R2 to R2 and see what is happening to the vectors geometrically. And I will say the very next section, which will be the topic of the next video, will go a lot more in detail, but it's nice to think about what's happening geometrically now on our introduction to video. Okay, so if you notice here what I have plotted, I have E1, this is the vector 1, 0, and then V2, the way I have it is 0, comma two, and they're plotted here in blue. The book calls this a standard L. I don't know if this is the L, if this is the L. I'm not sure if you're seeing my reflection or actually me. So I don't know which way is the L. In any case, this is what the text calls the standard L. And what we're going to do is just look at what happens to this L under a couple of different linear transformations, understand what's happening in the plane. The first one is the identity. So you see here the matrix is the identity. We just saw this for a 3x3, that the transformation corresponding to the identity matrix is, well, it's the identity map. So let's see this here. Okay, so here. Now, then below in red, oh, that might be the example coming next. There we go. There are an example coming later in this video. This is what is, what I'm plotting here, if you look, is A times E1 and A times V2. And you see, this is the identity. Very nice. This is the identity map. Now, let's change this. What would happen if we multiply by 2 times the identity? Well, 2 times a matrix, we see here, 2 times the matrix just multiplies every single entry by 2, and this is 2 times the identity. And again, here is my standard L. Now what happens to it? Well, it looks like it has remained the same, that nothing happened, until you look here. Okay, this upper, this is 4 and not 2, and this is 2 and not 1. So the length has changed. This vector that was length 2 has been stretched, is now length 4. The vector that was length 1 has been stretched, is now length 2. So this transformation is scaling everything by a factor of 2. Okay. Now let's do a few more. One of them in the text, and this is exactly the example from the text, but it's also good to see in Maple, is this map. Now you see this is getting a little bit more exciting as to what's happening, and this we will build on more in the next section as well, but the matrix is this. You see 0, -1, 1, 0. Those are the 4 entries, and we see here that it's rotated this standard L by 90 degrees, right? So this transformation that goes from R2 to R2, so this is a transformation of the plane, this rotates by 90 degrees, and we can observe that by looking at the effects on this standard L, or these 2 vectors. Okay. And then maybe one more I will do, and this, I'll just take away this -1. We can see what happens. This matrix is not the identity, right? Instead of having ones down the main diagonal and zeros, we have zeros down the main diagonal and then ones. In any case, what's happening here? Uh-oh. Okay. Well, what is happening? It looks like we take the L and then we flip it along the line y equals x, or reflect along the line y equals x. And in fact, if you think about this algebraically, this is indeed what is happening, because imagine taking this matrix, 0, 1, 1, 0, multiply by a x, y. Okay, well, you can take, you would have 0 times x, 1 times y. The first entry of the result would be y. And then you'd have 1 times x, 0 times y. The second entry of the result would be x. So without a doubt, if you write that down, for example, you'll see it. This matrix is interchanging x and y, or the transformation, I should say. Well, both, really. They're interchanging x and y, and we see that. Let me go back down. We see that geometrically by reflecting about the line y equals x.
Well, here's another example, and it will lead us to a more general statement. So I'm saying that I'm going to define a linear transformation from R3 to R4 that is given by this matrix. So T of X is A times X, where A is this matrix, okay, which is a 4 rows, 3 columns, 4 by 3 matrix. And the question is, we want to find or calculate T of E1, E2, E3, and then I have listed these. Now, these vectors come up fairly often. They are called the standard vectors. And this is general. They're called the standard vectors in Rn. EI would have a 1 in the ith spot and a 0 everywhere else. And we just saw in that Maple session, I had E1 was one of my vectors and I labeled it that. Okay, so these are labeled like this. These are standard vectors in R3. Now, you likely have seen from either a calculus course or physics or something like this that when you're in R3, this one is often called I, and we have J and we have K for R3. But the E1, E2, etc., this notation is general for Rm. Okay. In any case, now let's do the problem. I was talking about those vectors. Well, if we take, we know that T of E1 must be this matrix A times 1, 0, 0. Maybe it's easiest to think about this one as linear combination of columns, where it's just going to be 1 times the first column. Oh, maybe I'll get a little more space. 2, 3, and then it'll be 0 times the other two columns, right? Maybe I won't even put that. And this is just 5, 4, 2, 3. You could also think about it by taking this row, dot it with 1, 0, 0, you get 5, 0, 0, and then 4, 0, 0, 2, 0, 0, 3, 0, 0, and you're left with exactly 5, 4, 2, 3. That's what another way to think about it. In any case, when we calculate T of E1, we get the first column. And continue. When we calculate T of E2, well, now I have a 1 in column 2. Again, if you think linear combination of columns, it's going to be 0 times the first column plus 1 times the second column plus 0 times the third column. And so we get just the second column, 1 minus 1, 0, 2. Finally, T of E3. We see we get the third. Okay, because, well, we have 0 times this column, 0 times this column, 1 times the third column. So T of E3 is the third column. This is a very important observation that when we take our transformation and evaluate at these standard vectors in Rn, we get the columns of the matrix and the corresponding column of the matrix. So here we get the first column, second column, third column, like this. Now, I mentioned there's a more general statement here, which is the main reason I did this example. So generally, we can say something that we saw in the example that is true. So suppose T, this will go from Rm to Rn, is a linear transformation. This means there is some matrix A such that T of X is A times X for every vector X in the domain Rm. Okay, well, how do you find the matrix? And this is what I'm stating now. So then, the matrix
for t is,
well, given the last example, this shouldn't be too much of a surprise, but it's exactly what we saw, where you take t of E1, this gives you the first column of the matrix. You take T of E2, this gives you the second column of the matrix, and you keep going. Our M, the domain, has M of these standard vectors. They have a 1, well, EI has a 1 in the ith spot, 0 everywhere else. So the very last column will be T of EM. And this is the matrix for the transformation. Okay, so now how can we use this in an example? So suppose I give you the following T, well, let's just say define. T, this is gonna go from, let's say, R4 to R2 via, well, I'm defining a function here. So T of X1, X2, X3, X4, here is an element in the domain, and I need to give you an element here in the codomain. Let's say I do 2, X3, and we do negative X4. Okay, find the matrix for the transformation T, or maybe I'll just say for T. Now, okay, you might even be thinking, how do you even know that this is a linear transformation? Well, one way, because all we know right now is the definition, right? Which means I could find a matrix A such that A times a vector gives me exactly this. And that's the way I will do. So first I'm just gonna find the matrix using this, and I will verify that the matrix times, X1, X2, X3, X4 gives me this. And then we would know sort of after the fact that T is a linear transformation. However, right after we do this example, I'll give you a characterization that you will be able to know precisely when you have a linear transformation without having to necessarily find the matrix to justify. Okay, well, here we go. What I need to do is evaluate. So if I evaluate T of E1, okay, well, that has a 1, 0, 0, 0. This is just 0, 0. And then T of E2, this vector has 0, 1, 0, 0. And again, this will go to 0, 0. So far, these aren't very interesting. T of E3, okay, well, that's 0, 0, 1, 0. This is going to go to 2 times 1 and then 0. And finally, T of E4, that one is 0, 0, 0, 1. This maps to 0, negative 1. 0, negative 1. Now, these are the columns of the matrix for T, and they need to go in the order. Okay. So the matrix for T is, there's T of E1, there's T of E2, there's T of E3, and there's T of E4. This should be the matrix. Now let's just check to make sure. I will do that up here rather than trying to squish it in the small corner of the board. So let's check. If I take A times X1, X2, X3, X4, I get 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Here. Maybe the dot product is easier here, so I don't have to write a linear combination of four rows. We'll just take row, a linear combination of four columns. We'll just take row dot this, and get our entries. That will be very fast. When I take this row, dot it with this vector, I get 2x3. And then when I take this row, dot it with this vector, I get negative x4, which is exactly, well, I'll just put a check. It's exactly what t of this vector is, okay? So in fact, by finding this a, we have proven that t is a linear transformation using definition, right? Okay, very nice. Now, maybe I wanna use the full board. Now I will give a characterization of when you know, let's say a map between Rm and Rn is a linear transformation. Okay, so this is a theorem. A function t that goes from Rm to Rn is a linear transformation if and only if we have two things hold. And the first one, it says that t of x plus y equals t of x plus t of y. And this is for all, well, x, y in the domain. So for all vectors in the domain, which is Rm. And secondly, we need that t of kx is kt of x. And this is for all x in Rm and scalars k. These were the two things we had at the very beginning of today's lesson for a matrix, right? That ax plus y is ax plus ay, and that akx is k times ax. So in a sense, now, this is an if and only if proof, which means there's two implications here. First would be, if you know you have a linear transformation, then you must show this holds. And then there's another implication in if and only if, is that if all you have is that this holds, you must show, in fact, you have a linear transformation. This is the way if and only if works. There's two directions, okay? But one way comes from what we started with today, which is why we started with it, in that if. So this way, and I'll even do my little arrows, this way of the if and only if is done, and this was at the start of today. If you have a linear transformation, well, by definition, there is a matrix A such that T of X is A times X. And then this just says that AX plus Y is AX plus AY. And this just says AKX is KAX, okay? So this direction we've already talked about. But the other direction I want to prove, this direction, which says you just have some function from Rm to Rm, it satisfies 1 and 2. You must then show it's a linear transformation, meaning you have to find the matrix A such that T of X is AX, okay? And it's exactly what we've been doing or did in the last example, but this is a proof, so we will do it. So here we go. We are only doing this direction. Let's assume T okay, we have this, it's a function, and it satisfies, oops, this should be satisfies 1 and 2. And what I need to do is find a, well, if we look at this, this is gonna be N by M matrix A with T of X is A times X. And this is the definition of linear transformation. So I can, if I can find this matrix, which I will, and I verify that A times X is T of X for every X in RM, then I'm finished. I know T is a linear transformation, and I'm just gonna use 1 and 2. Okay. Here we go. So we define A as follows. Well, it's T of E1, it's T of E2, out to T of EM, where E1 to EM are the standard vectors that we discussed. So let X equal X1, X2 to Xm. Okay, so here is an arbitrary element in my domain. And then what I will do is show that if I take A times X, I get T of X. And then this is the end. I would have found the matrix that satisfies this. In particular, we would have that T is a linear transformation. Here's my comment. Now that I have this, I'll do it in red. My comment is the following. I may write X as a linear combination of these standard vectors as follows. X is equal to X1 E1 plus X2 E2 plus X3 E3. Uh-oh, I put the hat in the wrong place. All the way out to Xm, Em, right? This hopefully is clear because look, this has a one in the first component, zeros everywhere else. If you multiply X1 times that, you get the vector that's X1, zeros everywhere else, right? Here, this has a one in the second component, zeros everywhere else. You multiply X2 by it, you get the vector that has X2 here and zeros everywhere else. And similarly for any one of these terms here, 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 or down the line, we have a XI in the ith component, zeros everywhere else. Add it up, we get exactly this vector X. Okay, I'm gonna need that in my proof though. So now let me erase some. I have to erase the statement of the theorem in order to prove it. But, okay, as long as I don't lose this direction. We have A, we have X, we have T, and the properties I erased are what I assume. Okay, 1 and 2. You're gonna have to remember them, or hopefully you wrote them down. Okay, here we go. So then, A, X is, well, let's write out maybe a few steps, especially because I'm moving. So let's write out the columns A, T1, or T of E1, T of E2, T of EM. Okay, and then times X, X1, X2,
XM.
Okay, now here we go. We're ready to go. Linear combination of columns is how I am thinking about this A times X. So this will be X1 T of E1 plus X2 T of E2 plus out to XM T of EM. Okay, this is how matrix times vector works, as we have discussed. Now, here is where I'm gonna have to use the properties that sadly I have erased off the board. But X1 is a scalar, and here is T applied to a vector. I may move the scalar inside. This was the second property. This is property two. Okay, so this is gonna be T of X1, E1. Similarly, this will be T of X2, E2. Similarly, down the line, I'm using property 2 over and over. This is T of XM, EM. Okay, now we're almost there. Because, look, I have a sum. Now, property 1 was about a sum of two vectors. T of X plus Y is T of X plus T of Y. But if you can do it for two, you can do it for any finite number, okay? This is one big T of X1, E1 plus X2, E2 all the way out to XM, EM. Now, if you want the reasons here in my steps, moving from this line to this line, as I mentioned, was property two. Moving from this line to this line was property one that we are assuming about the function, okay? And then finally, this is this observation that X is this linear combination of these standard vectors, exactly how I've written here. So we see X, so this is equal to T of X. And this is the end of our proof. So sadly, I don't necessarily like that. I stated the theorem, started to prove it, erased the theorem, finished the proof. So the proof begins here and then ends here. But I think it's okay. It's what we have to work with. Let's do this example. What I'd like to do is, how can you justify or prove that this here is not a linear transformation? Well, in your mind, you should be saying, of course it's not. I see a squared, right? There's an X1 squared here. So this is the problem, but how do you justify it? If we use the actual definition, there is no matrix. So that F of X is A times X. That's a hard thing to work with. But this other characterization, which was the theorem, is quite easy to work with. If we could just show it, it fails either property one or property two, or maybe it fails both properties, but you can just justify that it fails one of the two, and then you know it's not a linear transformation. Okay, maybe the first thing I will do is write this in vector form. So we do have a function that goes from R2 to R2, where F of, let's see, the variables are X1, X2. Well, I will say you could do this, and I'll leave it here. Sometimes when you have a bracket inside of a parentheses for evaluating a function, you will leave off these outside parentheses for F of X1, X2. You've probably seen that on the board already today, and this is fine as well, but I'll write it this way. F of this vector is, well, we see it here. This is like a Y is F of X. So this would be X1 squared, X1 plus X2. So let's justify that this is not linear by, well, we can find a counterexample to the statement that we must have either property one or property two. Let's work with property two. Okay, so if I take, so notice, F of
2, 0 is what? Well, you square 2, we get 4, and then we get 2 plus 0. Very nice. And on the other hand, two times f of 1, 0 is equal to, well, this is 2 times, if I put in 1, 0, I get 1, 1, which is 2, 2. Now we see that this is not a linear transformation, because in, for this example, we have f of 2 times 1, 0 is not equal to 2 times f of, like this. So what fails here is property 2. Therefore, f is not a linear transformation. So this is a way, of course, sometimes it's hard to talk and write at the same time. I was saying, of course, you see it's not, or hopefully in your mind, you realize it's not by seeing the squared. But if you really want to justify it, we can use this theorem that I mentioned. This one fails property 2. We have this constant times this vector. Evaluate the function. It's not equal to 2 times f of the vector right here.